What's cracking, big dogs? Welcome back to the HQ. Welcome back to the channel. Welcome back to the podcast, however you are joining us. Jermaine's Nicholas. Big dogs gotta eat. BDGE Fantasy Football. Another good video in store for y'all today. Yesterday we did my favorite wide receiver sleepers, getting picked at 100 or later. So an ADP of 100 plus. We're gonna do the same thing with running backs today. Now I have three of them for you, along with some honorable mentions, along with some handcuffs I want to talk about. So a little bit of extra information at the end of this video, so stay tuned all the way through it. Right now, we're going to talk about my favorite running backs being picked at 100 or later that have a decent probability of breaking out, giving you value, and returning some investment capital on your pick. Let's just get right into the video. So I want to start this episode off with a little preface to my analysis, and because I think this article that I ran across is going to help a lot of you guys out, and I think it's going to put some things into perspective for you. Now, this article is called How to Spot a Breakout Running Back, and it was written by J.J. Zachariasen. If you are not familiar with J.J. Zachariasen, he's one of the bigger names in the fantasy industry. He is basically the creator of the whole theory of late round quarterback, right? He was working for NumberFire, and he still is working for NumberFire, but since has been named the editor-in-chief for FanDuel. So he's moving up the ranks pretty quickly, but he's a guy who's been in the industry for a while, and he really knows his stuff. He's one of the few guys that I actually respect in the fantasy football industry. Not respect, but respect their work. Because I think a lot of guys just write a lot of noise, and it's not very good. But he is one of the guys that I think is awesome. So when I come across really good work, you know, that's what I kind of consider Big Dog Gotta Eat. I'm like the middleman, right? These guys like J.J. Zachariasen, they're like the Pablo Escobars, and you guys are like the nickel and diamond crackheads, right? And I'm just the middleman, and I gotta sprinkle that shit to you. I get it from the top dogs, give it to y'all. That's how I kind of consider myself. So when I run across good stuff, I love to share it with you. That is how I get a lot of my analysis. I don't always do all the heavy lifting and the groundwork, but when I do find something worth giving to y'all, I make sure that I do that. And this is one of those instances. And I will link the article down below. It's free to read. I'm not sure if you have to create an account on NumberFire or not, but either way, it's free to access. And again, the name of the article is How to Spot a Breakout Running Back. Anyways, I wanted to show you guys this list from the article that he compiled. And what he does is basically go back over the last, I think, 5, 6, maybe 7 years. He goes all the way back to 2011, and he found all of the running backs with an ADP of 100 or later were being picked at spot 100 or later, and he put them in order in terms of most fantasy points that they scored, outscoring their ADP. So basically, like, he went back historically, is what they do at NumberFire. They have a chart that shows you, like, on average, depending on where you're picked in the draft, how many PPR fantasy points you can expect to score that year. So, you know, if pick like 130, you pick a guy, there's an average number of fantasy points that guy is going to score. And obviously, the later you get in drafts, the lower the expected fantasy points go. So they use that as like the preliminary basis of their research. And so he looked at the guys that were being picked at 100 or later, compared them to what they were expected to end the year with in terms of fantasy points, and he organized this list by the guys who outscored their projected fantasy points by the most. So you're talking about breakout running back. Broke out and weren't expected to score this many points. And that's what this list is. I don't want to sound like I'm reiterating everything that he's saying, because you guys can obviously go read the article. But like I said, people deserve credit where it's due. Go follow him at Late Round Quarterback. He has the Late Round Podcast and Live the Stream Podcast as well. He was listed as one of the top podcasts in my draft guide. In this article, he identified 4 trends that were basically common between almost all the guys on that list. And those are the top 24 breakout running backs since 2011. I want you to keep these trends in mind when you are picking late round running backs and when you are drafting guys that you think might break out. And the 4 trends are this. Trend number 1, there are almost never handcuffs. So you'll see a lot of breakout articles this summer, and you'll see people listing Spencer Ware and Gio Bernard and Austin Eckler and all these guys who are handcuffs. James Conner. It's so easy to just say, yeah, James Conner is going to be a beast if Le'Veon Bell goes down, but that's horrible analysis. That doesn't give you any sort of standalone value, right? Those aren't guys that you want to have on your bench because you're waiting for an injury to happen, and that's just stupid because they're not predictive. You can't predict injuries. So they were almost never handcuffs is what he found, which was interesting because you would think that maybe some of the breakout running backs would be, but that has not been the case. So trend number 1, Breakout running backs are almost never handcuffs. Trend number two, they are part of ambiguous backfields, meaning the backfields are unclear. And all of the guys in that chart that were listed before were not the first guys taken in fantasy drafts out of their respective backfields. So obviously they are guys that were not expected to be the starter. They came from unclear backfields. They didn't have a clear number one in the backfield. And these guys emerged as the year went on. Trend number three, they are pass catchers. The craziest part, I think, about all of the guys on that list, the top 24, is he went back and looked at the average reception total of all of those guys is 50 receptions on the year, which is crazy because 50 receptions will usually get you into like the top eight, top five of running back reception totals on the year. And obviously this list is going to be skewed because there are names like Alvin Kamara and there are the David Johnsons and there are some guys who caught like, you know, 80, 90 balls, which will bring up that average. But he's just saying that pass catching is a huge part of breaking out and exceeding your expectations as a fantasy running back. Trend number four, they come from good offenses. That is no surprise here. So almost never handcuffs, part of ambiguous backfields. They are pass catchers and they come from good offenses. Those are the four trends that were common among the top 24 breakout running backs since 2011. Now, these are obviously not the end-all be-all, and not everyone, you know, not every breakout running back is going to fit all of those criteria, but it's a really good baseline for what you should be looking for in late-round running backs or breakout running back candidates, especially if you're going with wide receivers early in the drafts and you pick some of these question marks in the middle of the rounds, like you pick an Alex Collins who might fall back into a committee, or you pick a Derrick Henry who might disappoint just because he's game script dependent. So you want to get these backup running backs, these insurance running backs in the later rounds that have high upside in case those running backs don't work out for you. So keep those trends in mind, and I would say at a minimum, make sure the guys you pick hit two of these, if not three of these trends. So with that, all that being said, I hope that helped you guys out. If it did, make sure you drop a thumbs up down below, guys. It lets me know that you appreciate the work I put in, because I appreciate you guys listening to my content as always, and I love having you here, and I love when you comment and give me the thumbs up, man. Lets me know that that you all still got love for me even after all this time. I can't imagine why anyone would listen to me for this long, but let's dive into my top three running back sleepers for 2018 fantasy football. Number one, Peyton Barber, Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Current ADP, 116 overall, running back 43. Y'all are probably sick of hearing me talk about him. I've talked about him more than anyone that you've heard since the start of preseason. But I promise I have some new information and some different angles and points of view to bring to you about Peyton Barber that I don't think I have touched on yet. People still really think that Ronald Jones is going to be the starter by like week two or three or four. They think Barber is a joke. They think he's going away for some crazy reason, and it just doesn't make sense to me. So all summer, we heard reports that, you know, Barber was really competing, and he might emerge as a starter, and he could be the number one on their depth chart. And you say to yourself, like, yeah, you hear those reports, but it's probably noise, and Ronald Jones was a second-round pick, and, you know, they want him to be the starter there. So, hey, when preseason games start, that's when we'll know, right? And that's when Jones will probably take over the first string role, and that's when he'll emerge and we can stop all this Barber talk. And then preseason week one happened and literal opposite of that happened. Barber came out as a starter. Barber played 13 of 14 first string snaps with this offense, and it was much of the same in weeks two and in weeks three of the preseason. Barber finished the preseason rushing 15 times for 87 yards and 2 touchdowns. That's 5.8 yards per carry with 4.1 yards after contact, 0.33 tackles evaded per attempt. Looking back at last year, again, I repeat, 0.33 tackles evaded per attempt. Last year in 2017, among all running backs with at least 100 carries, the highest mark was Alvin Kamara for that with 0.23 tackles evaded per attempt. Barber's been at 0.33 throughout the preseason. Obviously, there's a ridiculously small sample size, but I just want to note that to you guys because I think it is notable. Barber also caught all three of the targets that were thrown his way. Meanwhile, you look at Ronald Jones, he's out here racking up 18 yards on 18 carries. He has dropped two of his three targets, and he's looking like the second coming of Ameer Abdullah. Had Ameer Abdullah had his powers sucked out of him like this was Space Jam. That's what Ronald Jones has looked like so far this preseason. I can't really say I'm surprised. Now, we have Dirk Cutter, right, their head coach out here saying that he would be comfortable giving Barber 20 touches a game. He was like, you know, if we gave him 20 touches a game, I think we'd like what came out of this. And that's saying that he would be comfortable using Peyton Barber as the workhorse. Now, Barber is a guy with a three-down skill set. As much as you think he might be just a guy or he's just a name or a body to stick in there, Barber does encapsulate a lot of things that you look for in a workhorse running back. Well, let's cover all bases here. We're talking about handling a big load. I think he's similar to the Rachel Starr of handling a big load. I think he could absolutely pull this off and be Peyton Barber, thus is the Rachel Starr of fantasy football. Y'all hear what I'm saying right now? But let's look at it. Over the last five games of 2017, Barber handled over 18 touches a game. Over 18 touches a game. He became a starter. He started over Doug Martin. He started becoming the back that the Buccaneers coaching staff saw as one that could handle the entire load. He's 5'10", about 225 pounds. He is big. He can handle this work if need be. Early down work, he's already getting all of that as it stands. He is the between the 20s early down guy for the Bucs. Pass catching, like I said, he proved that he could do that. He caught 3 of 3 targets this preseason. He caught multiple passes in 4 of those 5 games in which he was the lead back down the stretch last year. And now with Charles Sims on the IR, it's really just between Barber and Ronald Jones for that passing down work. And, you know, Ronald Jones is a guy who came out of college with the pass catching ability as a question mark. Now, I'm not saying he's not capable of catching the ball, but he's dropped 2 of 3 targets already this preseason. He came out of college catching 32 passes in 40 collegiate games, which is, if you do the math, less than one catch per game. So that was a huge red flag coming into it. The thing that's most notable here, the Buccaneers running backs coach, this was a report that just came out, Tim Spencer literally said there is, quote, probably a reason second round running back Ronald Jones wasn't more involved in USC's passing game. Do you understand how bad he has had to have been or how frustrated this coach has to be with Ronald Jones in that part of the game? For you to have been working with Ronald Jones as a running backs coach, you're working with Ronald Jones for months already at this point by the time he said this. You're working with him for months, and then you come out and publicly humiliate Ronald Jones. You publicly say that about Ronald Jones. That tells me how far down he is in the depth chart in terms of the passing game. You don't have a coach that comes out and publicly criticizes that part of the game. You would say something like, you know, there's still a little bit of work that needs to be done, but he's progressing well. You don't say, you know, there's probably a reason why he wasn't involved in the passing game in his, you know, in his college days and things like that. So that's a huge red flag to me. And like I said, J.J. Zachariasen, you know, passing game is one of those trends. It's one of those big factors that comes into a breakout running back. And what other valuable carries do we have? The goal line carries, and that is 100% Barber. Like I said, he has 20 pounds on Ronald Jones. Ronald Jones is not a goal line back. This is going to be Barber. We saw him get the goal line carries at the end of last year, and we've already seen it this preseason. He has 2 touchdowns. One of them came from the 4-yard line. He is getting the goal line carries in this offense, guys. Basically, I'm just afraid people are writing Barber off as, like I said, a jag, just a guy. But I think he deserves more credit. Like last year, yes, you could look at his numbers and say he averaged 3.9 yards per carry. But guys, he was at 2.7 yards after contact. And that was, think about that. 3.9 yards per carry, but 2.7 yards after contact. That tells me that's an offensive line problem, not a running back problem. They've since added Ryan Jensen as the center, and he was one of the big free agent pickups on the O-line. But that being said, like down the stretch last year in those 5 games when he was a workhorse, that yards per carry bumped up to 4.3 yards per carry. So I'm not worried about Barber's efficiency. I think he is a much better back than people are giving him credit for. And, you know, you look at other websites and other analysis. I was looking at Football Outsiders. He was a top 15 running back in the NFL last year per their DVOA. And per Player Profiler, he ranked 14th among NFL running backs in yards created per carry. So, you know, Barber is set up for a big workload in 2018. I just don't want you to pass him by in your drafts because he's not a flashy name and you don't think there's upside, because there's absolutely upside. He checks 3 of the 4 boxes for JJ. He is an ambiguous backfield who is not the highest drafted guy. He is, I forget even what the damn trends were. He is not a handcuff, obviously, and he is capable of catching passes, and he's probably going to be the pass-catching role in this offense. The only thing, obviously, is how good is this offense going to be. But, you know, again, the volume should be there. So I am drafting Barber wherever I can get him, as late as I can get him. Now, he's probably going to move up a little bit in terms of ADP because he's getting a lot of hype from people like me, but I still think Barber is as solid as you can get in like the 8th round in terms of running back value. So Barber, number 1. Move on to number 2. Corey Clement of the Philadelphia Eagles. currently being picked 131 overall, running back 51. So we got Mr. CC's over here, revving his engine. He's ready to go for the 2018 fantasy football season, and I don't think he's going to disappoint. You saw the Eagles is forego the running back position in free agency in the NFL draft this year, so they're left with just JJ, Corey Clement, and Darren Sproles to fill the backfield and get the touches in this backfield. Now, Corey Clement, for those of you who don't really know him, he's an undrafted free agent out of Wisconsin. He's turning 23 in the middle of, or he turned 23. Let me check this, actually. JWI, just wait on it. Okay, so he's 23 right now. He'll turn 24, still very young. He'll turn 24 in November. He's a big motherfucker. 5'11", 220, or 5'10", 220. But still a big, 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 big build. He's got that workhorse size if he needs it. What stuck on a lot of people's minds was the Super Bowl win for the Eagles, right? Clement went off. He went for 108 and a tutty. 108 total yards, most of it receiving work. But he scored that touchdown, and that was kind of like the awakening to Corey Clement. And you're like, wow, this guy could be a player in this offense next year. So he wrapped up a nice rookie season with that Super Bowl performance. He scored 6 times on just 84 touches last year while splitting the backfield with like 1,000 running backs. So he did it with not a lot of opportunity. He was able to score 6 touchdowns. He beat out Wendell Smallwood. He beat out Donald Pumphrey, who went to the IR and is in danger of losing his spot already this year. LeGarrette Blount and his 181 touches are gone. They're in Detroit. Darren Sproles is like 35, coming off a very serious injury, and I'm not completely sold that he's going to be, you know, a big part or a big contributor of this offense. Might surprise me, but I don't think I'm not really too worried about Darren Sproles. The guy to be worried about, of course, is Jay Ajayi in this backfield, and it's probably going to be his backfield for the near future, I would say. And I know this is horrible analysis, and I already said that this was horrible analysis, but if something were to happen to JJ, obviously Corey Clement is going to become the guy here, and he's going to be heavily used and going to be, it's just going to have a huge workload. But that's not the reason why I like Corey Clement, and that's not the reason why he is on this list. For one, this is a great offense, and I think that is a very underrated part of looking for later round running backs. A great offense with an ambiguous backfield, which is what J.J. Zacharyson pretty much said. And that's what we have for Clement. Now, Clement's missed the last few weeks of practice for the Eagles because of an ankle injury, but he has since returned and he's ready to go. He'll be ready for week one. So there's no worries there. He'll be all systems go week one at Atlanta. Oh, no. They're at Philly. Home game for Philly against Atlanta, who I might mention gives up the most goddamn fantasy points to running backs who catch passes in the NFL over the last few years. Atlanta's horrible at defending. Actually, that's their defense. They give up, they let you have what's in front of them, and then they use their speed to close in on you. But that's big for fantasy purposes because you can start a lot of pass-catching backs against them, which I think Clement will be heavily involved in. However, while Clement's missed practice, so has Ajayi. It's been almost 2 weeks now that Ajayi has been out of practice with what's being called a lower body injury. He's yet to return. It could be completely cautionary, and these reports could have no legs to him, that anything about this injury is serious, but it also could not. You never know. And we're less than a week away from the NFL season, and he is not back at practice. And considering they're playing on Thursday Night Football, who knows, man? Who knows what's going on with Ajayi there? So we're yet to kind of get a deeper dive into what's going on with the injury, but it's definitely noteworthy considering the amount of time he has missed. To go back to Clement and this team overall, the Eagles are a pretty damn good team, wouldn't you say? They're definitely not a bad team, and that's what you look for in running backs. You want running backs on a good team. It's a team with a very good offensive line that should have plenty of scoring opportunities here. So Clement, like I said, is a bigger back, right, at 220 pounds, and with Blount gone, there's a good chance that Clement takes a lot of those goal line opportunities, and he kind of fills in for that role that Blount had. Now, Blount last year ranked 10th in the NFL with 10 rushes inside the 5. So he had 10 goal line rushes, and he ranked top 10 in the NFL. And in the previous years, even prior to Blount, the Eagles' goal line rush volume has always been very high. So whoever wins that role is going to be very valuable on its own, and I think Clement, just given what we saw last year, has a good chance to do that. Ajayi didn't have a single goal line carry in the regular season in 2017. Not in Miami, not in Philly. Now, he was utilized a small amount in the playoffs for Philly, but throughout the entire regular season, Ajayi did not have a single goal line carry. Where else Clement kind of excels is, you know, obviously in the passing game. He caught a pass in 8 of their last 9 games, including the playoffs, and he had a 5-catch game against Atlanta. And then, of course, like I just said, he exploded in the Super Bowl. He caught 4 passes for 100 yards and a tutty. And what else might keep Clement on the field, more so on third downs, is his pass blocking skills. And this will ultimately lead to more work, in my opinion. Clement graded out as Pro Football Focus's 2nd highest graded rookie running back in pass blocking, only behind Jamal Williams last year, 7th overall among all NFL running backs, or among 46 qualified NFL running backs. Very good pass blocker. And you have a guy like Carson Wentz coming back from an injury, that's going to be a concern, or that's going to be a priority for them, is to keep him healthy. So Clement has shown that he can be a third down back there because he's good in the passing game, he's good in the pass blocking game. And then I wanted to dive a little bit deeper, as I usually like to do, in terms of efficiency and look at, you know, is he even a good player? Clement, you know, he could run into this opportunity, but how efficient is he? Is he going to be good with a small amount of touches if he doesn't end up taking the Ajayi role, if he doesn't end up becoming a starter at some point this year? So I wanted to look at Football Outsider, footballoutsiders.com, always a good, great resource for y'all to use. And I wanted to see his efficiency from last year. Now, obviously, it was a small sample size, so his volume wasn't big enough for him to qualify for the normal running back section among the guys who had, I think, like over 100 carries and 26 receptions or something like that. But among 56 running backs that had 100 carries or less, or had less than 100 carries, among 56 of them, his rushing grade or his rushing efficiency and success, his DVOA, ranked 5th among 56. And his receiving grade was number 1 among all of those running backs with the smaller sample size. So he was efficient last year. And just like Peyton Barber, guys, I don't want you to write Clement off as just a guy or just a name with, you know, because he's not flashy and he doesn't have crazy upside, you would say. But I'm telling you, both of those guys have pretty good floors and crazy, crazy upside. So we'll have to see what shakes up with Ajayi. We'll have to see if this injury is anything big. And it's probably going to take a few things to break right for Clement to, you know, take on a bigger role and this breakout to kind of come to fruition. But he's not only a guy to stash and kind of wait on, I think he really is going to have this goal line role in an offense that should have tons of scoring opportunities. So I think he gives you some standalone value as well. So do not sleep on my man's Corey Clement out in Philly. Before we get to numero tres, if you're cramming for your draft, you got your draft this weekend coming up, whether it's tomorrow, Sunday, Monday, whatever, I have a draft guide available for purchase, which includes all of my sleepers, all my top sleepers for all the positions, my top busts, players to avoid and stay away from, my must draft players, my overall rankings, my top 250 rankings, along with positional rankings by tiers, as my favorite podcasts to listen to, my favorite resources, websites, and stuff to look at, along with my Bible, which is like 8,000 words on how to attack your draft strategy this year. It's just a ton of value. So it's kind of like a one-stop shop for anything you would need for your draft this year. And that's kind of the idea behind why I put it together, because there are so many resources. And like I said, I like to be the middleman for a lot of this stuff. So I use these outside resources to put together a draft guide for y'all. If you have not purchased it, it's one of the first links down below. You'll see me, it's like all caps, like buy my goddamn draft guide. But it just shows support to me. It's obviously I put so much time and work into these videos and all this stuff. So if you need something for your draft, you know, it's available on your phone, your laptop, your tablet. It's completely interactive. It's got videos, all exclusive stuff that won't be on my YouTube and on my blog and stuff like that. So you can go cop that right now. The link will be down below. I would appreciate that. And I love all y'all that have already purchased a draft guide. Thank you so much for the support. And if you are enjoying the video, again, guys, please leave that thumbs up button and subscribe to the channel if you are new. We'll be hitting you with videos like this all season long. And, you know, I just love when y'all support me, and I love to support you back. So drop some comments, some questions down below, and I'll try to get around to answering every single one of them. But let's move on to running back number 3, and that is Jordan Wilkins of the Indianapolis Colts, of the Indianapolis Andrew Lux. Current ADP, 157 overall, running back 58. Now, there's arguably no running back situation more murky than the Colts' backfield right now. Or as J.J. Zachariasen, I guess, would put it, ambiguous. Considering the amount of heads here. Now, there is sophomore Marlon Mack. There are the rookies, Nyheim Hines and Jordan Wilkins. And then there are the journeymen, Robert Turbin and Christian Michael. I'm actually interested to see if they cut any of these running backs or if they keep 5 of them on their roster. I think cut day is, I think September 1st, they have to have their roster down to 53 by like 4 p.m. Eastern time. So that will be, I think if you're seeing this video, it's August 31st. So by tomorrow, we'll know if they're keeping all five running backs on the roster. Imagine like Jordan Wilkins just gets cut. That'd be really shitty for me. But yeah, so they have a lot of heads back there right now. And I would say that Jordan Wilkins, obviously, just given the situation, has a very, very, very low floor. But I love his ceiling. And when you look at his skill set, when you consider his skill set, I also think he has the ability to make most of the guys in this backfield redundant and kind of, you know, not needed, and could take over this backfield and receive the high majority of work here. So let's kind of just dive in, and I'll tell you why I feels this way, why I'm in my feels about Jordan Wilkins. We'll start with the other guys first and kind of attack why I think they will flop, why you should fade them, and why Wilkins is a better bet. We'll start with Mac, right, who is presumed to be the starter, and he was the starter in their week one preseason game. But he pulled up with a hamstring injury that was pretty serious. I don't want to say it's like severe, but it's semi-serious considering he's already missed weeks of practice time. He's been sidelined since that week one game, and there's no assurance that he is going to be ready for week one. They're saying he's progressing. Like, obviously, you're not going to start regressing for no reason. As time passes, you'll heal and you'll get better. But no one's come out and said, yep, he's going to be ready for week one. He's our week one starter. We don't know if he's going to play in week one. Hamstring injuries that you go into the season with are extremely scary. If you are not 100% prior to the season starting, I will usually fade players with hamstring injuries. Again, people love to talk about Saquon Barkley. I've seen videos of him like up to a week and a half ago, 2 weeks ago. He looks like he's 100%. They're absolutely just resting their number two overall pick. They're taking no chances with him. So this does not apply to Saquon Barkley. If you're heading into the season with a hamstring injury, there is a good chance that you're just going to try to push yourself. And in Mac's case, he's fighting for a job, right? Mac is missing valuable practice time in which he needs to be beating out these other guys for that top of the depth chart spot, right? This is a new regime, new coaching staff, a new offensive scheme with Frank Wright coming in. And it's not like Mac was picked by or handpicked by this coach, right? He's not someone that they wanted really bad. He just kind of inherited to him. So I think that says to me that there's no guarantee that Mac comes back as a starter. And this is valuable practice time that he's missing. And, you know, that might actually push him to return quicker than he should. And if you return with this hamstring injury quicker than he should and you're trying to push it, there is a much more likely chance of you re-injuring it. So Mac kind of scares me with the hamstring injury while he loses all these practice reps. And we've had Jordan Wilkins running with the ones at practice. We saw him start the third preseason game. He led the team with 14 carries. So like I said, there's no guarantee that Mac returns. We don't know when he's going to return, but there's no guarantee that he returns to the starting role when he does. Nyheim Hines profiles as more of like an athlete, a gadget player, someone that you actually design plays for out of the backfield. He's like 5'8", 195, 198 pounds or something like that. He never had a shot of taking over this backfield and being a featured workhorse or anything here. So I'm not worried about Hines. He's the least likely guy to affect Wilkins' playtime. And Hines has been absolutely horrible this preseason. So I would honestly, I'm not even sure that we should expect him to play a big role in the regular season, even on like passing down roles. So that's Mac, that's Hines. Christian Michael is the other back that will probably split times with Wilkins in the early down role if Mac isn't healthy. Thing I would say about Michael is like, yes, he is ahead there and he will be a guy that will probably take some early down role, but guys, this is going to be his sixth year in the NFL and he is what he is. Talk about his spark score all you want. He's just a guy. He has not proven to anyone that in a bigger sample size, he could be anything more than just a head in the backfield. So the difference between these two is just we have the unknown factor with Wilkins, right? Wilkins hasn't performed great in preseason, but again, I don't look at box scores when I talk about preseason. The usage totals are much more telling about predictive volume, and that's what we chase in redraft, guys. We chase volume. So with Michael, sixth year in the NFL, we've seen nothing out of him that would suggest he's going to randomly take over this featured role. So between the two of them, I would definitely put my money on Wilkins, especially going this late in the drafts and in fantasy drafts. And you have Robert Turbin, who is suspended for the first four games because of PED use. He's like a bowling ball. And I'd imagine when he comes back, he'll have the goal line role, or that's what he had last year. But again, guys, four games is a big percentage of your fantasy season, a big percentage of the regular season too. So if someone steps up, if Jordan Wilkins steps up and he performs well on the goal line, if he rushes a couple times, like if he goes 2 for 2 or 3 for 3 on the goal line, What reason would the Colts coaching staff have to just throw Turbin back into the mix and just say, you know what, this is your role again, when someone else has already, you know, got that mojo going and has the success on the goal line already? So my thing against Turbin is just the fact that he's missing this time and he's giving other people the chance to take that role away from him. So there are obviously a lot of dominoes here that need to kind of fall, but I don't think they're unreasonable, right? You have the serious injury to Mac, which is very real. Hines has been very bad, and he's just a gadget player pretty much. Michael has proven nothing in 6 years in the NFL, and Turbin is suspended for 30% of the real of the regular season of your fantasy game. So while it's a lot, you know, it's a lot of talking points, I think all of them are very reasonable in terms of Wilkins becoming the guy. So those are all the other guys, but let's talk about like Wilkins as a back. As I was saying, he has a three-down skill set, which we saw at his final year at Ole Miss, right? He rushed for over 1,000 yards. He scored 9 rushing touchdowns. He was a feature back there. He averaged 6.5 yards per carry in the SEC. That is the division that that Ole Miss plays in, the conference. I'm sorry. He also showed his passing skills in his senior year at Ole Miss. At Ole Miss, he caught 26 balls. For 241 yards, and 26 passes is no joke when you are in college, right? Because they obviously have a small, limited number of games. So 26 passes is a lot more than most of the rookie backs that came into the league this year had. So that shows that he can play on third down as well. He caught 3 or more passes 5 times last year. He also had multiple games where he caught 5 or more catches. He's shown that he could be an early down runner, right? He's got the productivity against SEC defenses. And talking about the SEC defenses, played against Alabama. In that game, he went 12 for 101. Played against Mississippi State, where he went 14 for 110 and 2 touchdowns. And then Auburn, he went 13 for 65 and a score. Obviously, 65 yards is nothing crazy, but still over five yards per carry, and he scored a touchdown. He's 6'1", 216 pounds, so he's got that workhorse size if they give him the opportunity to be that. Like I said, he's got the three-down skill set. He's got the size. He can handle a big load. He can catch passes. Now, the good thing about Wilkins is this. You can get him extremely late in drafts, and I think you're going to know what you have with Wilkins from a fantasy perspective right out of the gate, right? So if he starts off really hot, if he gets off to a really strong start when the regular season kicks off, I think it becomes his job to lose, and I think you're going to be really happy that you drafted him. However, if he starts slow, if he's in a really big timeshare, and he doesn't perform over the first couple weeks, and then you're starting to get Mac back more healthy and Turbin's coming back in a couple weeks, you'll know that you can safely drop him and then he's probably not going to emerge. So I think with Wilkins, you're pretty much going to know early on in the season whether or not you should roster him. So he's someone that you can pretty much safely drop after the first 2 or 3 weeks. So he's a guy that you're investing very little capital in with a chance to return, in my opinion, very, very good upside. So those are my three sleepers going at pick 100 or later for the running back position this year. I have some honorable mentions, and I want to talk about handcuffs as well. But before we do that, I want to thank today's sponsor for the video, FantasyJocks.com. Y'all know them. If you've watched any of my videos, they sponsor all my videos because they're the GOAT. GOATs do GOAT things. GOATs produce GOAT products like this. This championship belt right here, flawless. I'm telling you, these are only the highest quality products, yo. I've been using them in all my leagues for the last like 4 or 5 years. FantasyJocks.com. They lead the industry in fantasy football, actually any fantasy sports league equipment. They've been rated number one by the FSTA, the Fantasy Sports Trade Association. That's like the legit people in the fantasy industry, apparently. Those are the gatekeepers, but they ranked Fantasy Jocks with the number one trophies and number one gear, number one ranked gear for your league, whatever it is. They have championship belts just like this, a little more expensive, but very high quality. They have trophies like Lombardi trophies, which are less expensive if you're looking for that kind of thing. They have rings that you can get for your winner each year. They have draft boards. If you're drafting with your boys, you're doing a live draft this weekend, make sure you cop one from Fantasy Jocks like yesterday. Actually, go onto the website, hit the link down below right now and order that and get expedited shipping if you need one. Because there's still a couple days left that you can grab it. So they got all that kind of stuff for your league gear. You can get the champion's team name engraved on the side of the belt or on the trophy. Guys, I'm telling you, these products are awesome. If you have everyone just chip in a few dollars from your league, you can afford it. If the buy-in's 50, have everyone pay $58 and you're set with a trophy that you can pass around for years and years and years and tell your ancestors and your forefathers about your fantasy football championship in 2018. That's what Fantasy Jocks is about. It's about playing for more than just money. It's about pride. It's about wearing a goddamn belt out to the bar with all your boys and making them feel like POSs because you watch Big Dogs Gotta Eat Fantasy Football and we led you to the promised land. That's what Fantasy Jocks is about. Take 10 or Taco Corp promo codes you could use for 10% off. Take 10 or Taco Corp. Link down below, fantasyjocks.com. Thank you for sponsoring today's video. I really need to get a script because my plugs are just getting worse and worse as the summer goes by. But let's talk about my honorable mentions. Now, these are just a couple names that I didn't put in here because they are not going at pick 100 or later, but they're going pretty late, and there's a possibility that they might fall past the pick 100 in your draft, and they should be picked inside the top 100. So if they're not, they're what we call steals. And the two guys are obviously Chris Carson and Jamal Williams. They are slated to be the lead backs in their respective offenses. If nothing else, they will have a lot of volume, at least in the beginning of the year. And if they can secure that role, then they could be, I want to say league winners, but I think Jamal Williams has a very good shot to be league winner this year. So I'm super excited about Jamal Williams, and I'm trying to grab him in most of my redraft leagues this year. And Aaron Jones is another guy that I know a lot of people love, and he actually fits most of JJ's criteria, the four trends. He actually fits all of them, all four of them above. But I think people are getting unrealistically high about his talent. Now, I made an In the Muck Monday video where I compared Aaron Jones and Jamal Williams, and this was like 2 or 3 months ago, so obviously a lot of the stuff doesn't hold steady now. And I picked Aaron Jones at the time, but this was prior to a lot of different things that happened this summer. Aaron Jones has obviously dealt with both hamstring and concussion injuries during these summer months. He's missed tons of practice time because of it. He's already suspended for the first two games of the season. So he's got so much working against him right now that I think that that's Jamal Williams' job to lose. Now, you could say that Aaron Jones has more talent because he probably does as a running back, but all of these things add up to tell you that he's not going to get a lot of opportunity to start. And looking back at last year, and I've said this multiple times throughout the year, throughout the summer, Packers want to use one featured back, guys. They had a single running back. So they had in their 16 games last year, there was one running back in 10 of 16 games that had 20 or more touches. And there was one running back that had 15 or more touches in 12 of 16 games. So it's clear that in these games, they wanted to use one workhorse running back, but no one could stay healthy. Now, Jamal Williams gets the first crack at that. And if he could play successful behind Aaron Rodgers, which I expect him to do, it's going to be his job to lose. They're not just going to insert Aaron Jones into a 15-touch workload because they want to use one workhorse, man. They want to keep Jamal Williams on the field. So like I said before, second highest graded pass blocking running back in the NFL last year. Number one amongst rookies. That's going to be a concern for them as Aaron Rodgers is coming back from a serious injury. So don't get unreasonably high by Aaron Jones. He's not a bad late round flyer pick because he does hit all these criteria, but those would be my honorable mention guys. And, you know, I don't really talk about handcuffs much because I don't really like taking them because you're literally just banking on an injury, which is not predictive. But I would say there are some clear-cut handcuffs right now in the NFL. If you are interested in knowing who they are, I'll lay them out for you. It is obviously Latavius Murray with the Vikings, who I think has standalone value, obviously. I was going to put him on this list, but I don't think that backfield is really ambiguous. I just think it's Cook's. It's easily Cook's backfield. Murray will have a goal line role, though. So the Vikings have Latavius Murray. The Chiefs have Spencer Ware. The Cardinals have Chase Edmonds. Steelers is James Conner behind Le'Veon Bell. The Chargers have Austin Eckler. And the Cowboys have Rod Smith. Rod Smith, low-key, I drafted him in a lot of best ball leagues because Zeke is going to touch the ball like 390,000 times. So if there's anyone that has a higher risk of injury, I would say it's Zeke, just given the amount of touches that he's going to get. So Rod Smith is a guy to keep an eye on, guys. He's a guy to keep an eye on if something weird goes on with Zeke. But those are the handcuffs. I actually didn't really look all over the NFL. Like, I didn't go through team by team and try to pick them out. Like, Gio would be the handcuff for Joe Mixon, of course. But those are guys that kind of came top of mind when I was doing this section. But that's going to wrap up the video, guys. If you enjoyed, make sure you hit that thumbs up. If you are new to the channel, make sure you subscribe because we will be putting out videos like this all season long, hopefully bringing y'all to the chip. Just hit that thumbs up button down below and share, subscribe. If you're on the podcast, leave a rating and review. I would very much appreciate that. And I'll see y'all. I don't know if I'm dropping a video tomorrow or not. I might be, but I might also be out this weekend kind of creeping around and you know, doing bad things with my friends for Labor Day weekend. Sunday, I definitely will be live streaming, though. Maybe I'll turn that into a Monday live stream because that's kind of the weekend, and I have my E-Town Get Down draft on Monday. I know a lot of y'all love that, so the draft is on Monday. The vlog for that draft will be up a few days later. And, you know, if you are drafting this weekend and I don't catch y'all again, good luck with your drafts, and I hope I helped you out. Go cop my draft guide. Peace!